The governing body of Winchester College recently released a document entitled Winchester College in the 21st Century, regarding the future of the school. Importantly, it begins the process of admitting girls and day pupils into the school and substantially increases the bursary fund combating perceived bias. In this video, I examine the history of bias at Winchester College through some of the many documents, pictures and paintings which help to tell the tale. Thank you to Miss Foster from the archives at Winchester for her help in finding some of the relevant items. The story of bias begins at the very beginning, with the statutes of the college depicted here. The statutes made many interesting provisions, most notably in rubric number 2, that every single one of those to be elected as scholars to our same college near Winchester is to be poor and needy. William of Wykeham founded Winchester College not for the rich and wealthy, but for the poor and needy. However, a footnote to rubric 16 of the statutes, dating not long after the foundation of the college, makes provisions for the sons of noble and influential persons, special friends of the said college, up to the number of 10, to be instructed in grammar within the same college, without burden upon the aforesaid college. Fee-paying commoners existed from the foundation. Some of the commoners boarded with the fellows, some with the scholars and some in town as day pupils, like the type Winchester will soon admit. By 1412, there were about 100 of these fee-paying commoners, a number which would not be matched until the 18th century. Although the fee-paying commoners were present, there was hardly any aristocratic bias at Winchester. A notable exception to this is when John Burton, a former headmaster who featured in the second video of my Winchester College on Fire series, commissioned portraits of 13 of the commoner aristocrats. Most of the homogeneous portraits now dominate the Master and College's dining room. To explore each individual portrait in much greater detail, visit my online museum. The link is in the description. Latin used to be compulsory in election, the scholarship exams. This made it incredibly difficult for pupils from state schools to succeed in them. Since 1968, however, this has not been the case. Here you can see a collection of newspaper articles about the decision, which was made jointly with Eton. I won't read the entirety of each article, but feel free to pause the video at the appropriate times to read them for yourself. Eton and Winchester to attract a wider field. Eton and Winchester have decided to open their doors to the spirit of reform. The governing bodies of both schools have revised their scholarship examinations to encourage candidates from a wider field. Latin will not be compulsory at examinations from the summer of next year. The governing bodies asked both headmasters to devise an examination which would attract a wider field of entry. Here is a document sent to prep schools about the changes. English, maths, a foreign language, and a general paper were compulsory, and the optional papers were more languages, more maths, another general paper, and science. Notably, science was optional. This is no longer the case, as you can see on the right. Proficiency in a language is no longer required to obtain the scholarship. Instead, a scientific mind is. The general format of the exams, however, is very similar, with 4 compulsory papers and at least 3 optional ones. George Richardson, a second master, was overshadowed by his wife, Sarah Richardson, or Mrs. Dick. She brought warm drafts of humanity into the austere lives of the scholars. This article in the Wykeham-ist illustrates this. Dear Sir, the paragraph in your issue of November the 10th reminds me of the story of the origin of the commemorative plaque outside 8 College Street, known in my day as Octos. Octo went to Mrs. Dick and said, "Will you put up a notice board outside my shop to say that Jane Austen died there?" Mrs. Dick replied, "Why, Octo?" Octo said, "Because Americans come in and want to know if she died there. They never buy anything and they waste my time." Mrs. Dick accordingly put up the nice oak tablet. 6 months later, Octo came again and said, "Will you please take that notice board down?" Mrs. Dick said, "Why, Octo?" And Octo said, "Because English people come in to know who Jane Austen was." I never pass that way without thinking with affection of all three characters in that little story. Yours faithfully, Frank D. Watney. The statutes, which we looked at earlier, through Rubric 45, specifically state that women should not do jobs around the college. Mrs. Dick was allowed free rein around her own house, but her offer to help in the college kitchen was politely refused. Mr. Richardson, in his retirement speech in 1899, called for co-education, the admission of girls into the school. An article in The Wykamist covers his speech. He, Mr. Richardson, owed much to his wife, who had ever been inspired by a similar sense of duty. He referred to the important and beneficent part which women's influence might play in the education of boys. He was a convert, he declared, to the mixed system, and he ventured bold prediction that in 50 years' time even some of the great public schools would be mixed schools for boys and girls. This is a daring prediction. It would be interesting to know whether Mr. Richardson's mixed schools of the future are to be boarding schools or day schools. Was the governing body right to admit day pupils and girls? I'll leave the answer to a DebSoc Debating Society debate in 1953, held jointly with Eastleigh County High School. Again, I won't read the whole of it, but feel free to do so for yourself. Debating Society. On Tuesday, March the 24th, a number of Wykamists took part in a joint debate with Eastleigh County High School, which was held at Eastleigh. The motion debated was that this House approves of co-education. Proposing the motion, J.J.F. Francis gave an uninteresting definition of co-education from the Encyclopaedia Britannica. He claimed that co-education was a success in America, that it made for an easy relation between the sexes, and that its difficulties were exaggerated. It had a long history, reaching back to the Greeks, and a successful one. The opposers might say that such things as games presented great difficulties, but these had been overcome in the past, and co-education had obvious advantages for acting, singing, and dancing. The proposer stressed again the success of co-education in America, and suggested that it made for economy in educational expenditure. Mr. B. Hockey, opposing the motion, set about showing the less advantageous sides of co-education. There were administrative difficulties. Boys and girls had different rates of development and needed different teaching. Under co-education, there could, for instance, be no uniformity of punishment. The Freudian might argue the education of the sexes together freed them from inhibitions. But might it not lead to a lack of proper respect between them? Separation of the sexes at this stage would lead to a stronger education, free from distractions and more suited to the special needs of those involved. G.R.H. Bredin traced a connection between the American divorce rate and the fact of co-education there. Relations were taken too much for granted. Co-education was not the natural thing it was claimed to be. It was more natural for the sexes, with their different interests, to go their own way in adolescence and to meet again when their interests coincided, for which reason segregated secondary schools were better. On the debate being opened to the House, T.C. Ulrich said that co-education was more natural, because a one-sided school community was no preparation for the world, and the problem of meeting the other sex was solved much earlier. The American divorce rate was caused by the lax divorce laws. The difficulties of administration in mixed schools could be overcome, and the social advantages were obvious. Mr. Bundy believed that co-education ruined boys' work. In a segregated school, you could find the other sex if you wanted it. In a mixed school, you couldn't get away from it. Familiarity bred contempt. A.R. Hamilton said that in Oxford, the sexes preferred not to mix in societies. The college secretary observed that the world's great art and music was produced by men, that American educational standards were shockingly low, and that a school like Bryanston, with a nearby sister foundation, had academic segregation together with the social advantages of co-education. Miss Greaves told the sad story of how co-education had shattered her illusions of the chivalry of men. Miss Day asserted that girls worked harder, and boys just as hard at co-educational schools. The pride in appearance and in oneself, and the easier friendships they made possible, were points in their favour. Absence might make the heart grow fonder, but didn't produce the necessary understanding. B. Jensen delivered a soulful plea that we should take sex seriously. Co-education produced a free and easy atmosphere which prevented a proper respect for it. One could get into considerable trouble if one treated sex as a trivial thing. J.E.E. Whittaker said that men did not live in one town and women in another. Mr. Nichols suggested a male teacher could secure respect in a co-educational school, but not a female teacher. Either she could not control the boys, or if she could, the girls hated her. Summing up, the opposer said that most of the arguments of co-education came from those with a stake in it. But the sexes did not help each other in a mixed school, and youth centres, not schools, were the place for the meeting of the sexes. The advantages of co-education were outweighed by its drawbacks. The proposer asserted once more that full education needed both sexes. The school was a microcosm of society, and there was no reason why secondary schools should reject what both kindergartens and universities accepted, and the world had proven right. The House divided, and the motion was carried by 60 votes to 18. We are most grateful to our hosts for this lively debate and for the hospitality which preceded it. We can only regret that time did not permit as many speeches as we should have liked. Thank you for watching this video about bias at Winchester College. If you enjoyed it, make sure that you like this video, subscribe to my YouTube channel, and visit my website, godtress.wixsite.com/cornucopia, for more content like this. Thank you.